someday. Sing along as the choir sways, every verse of amazing grace. Then I'll shake the preacher's hand, go home into your blue jeans, have some chicken and some baked beans, pick a backyard football team, not do much of anything. It's what I love about. Up to Sunday times, grab my coffee cup. It looks like Sally and Rob finally tied the knot. Well, it's about time. 35 cents off a brown, brown baby, cut that coupon out. Doing this morning. Looks like we made it out. Slid in here again.
And nobody came through the front doors with their car. That's awesome.
I don't know about y'all, but I am ready for some sunshine. You ready, Katie?
I'm ready.
All right.
All ready. You made it. Might as well be alive.
Secure from been absent for 2 weeks. We talked about him last week. Did you watch last week while you were snowed in? You did. We tried to do it. We tried to do one for you.
Did you? Can you hear me? I can't hear me, but you can hear me, right? Hang on.
You leave for 2 weeks, we start turning your stuff off.
Apparently the electric company thinks I left too then. Let's do a new song. I looked this one up this morning. I think it appears in print about 1920 or 1930, something like that. So it's going to soon celebrate a big birthday, be 100 years old. Talks about how good it's going to be when this is all over.
Children's Church. You guys got a big treat this morning because I'm headed straight up there after this to help out. We're going to have a good time.
Be prepared.
All right, let's pick the pace up a little bit. Let's everybody stand up. And still in honor of flu season, let's wave at someone across the arena or give them a fist bump. No handshakes.
Oh, happy day.
Happy day.
Quick announcement, Women's Retreat is the end of March, 15th and 16th, and we need some volunteers. So if you're able and would love to volunteer, please meet in the office after church. Okay, this past weekend, I experienced some violence. Y'all are real quiet now. It's pinata violence. At a six-year-old birthday party, lots of violence, and I think we're going to see it here in just a second. I didn't want y'all to miss out on all the violence. There we go. Okay, I just want you to know that that didn't bust that pinata. No. We had to finally knock it down and stab it with the stick. It got worse. And then there was some ripping apart of the legs. It was violence. But finally we got the candy out, because, you know, that's the whole goal, get the candy out. And then all the kids got to pick, you know, which favorite candy is theirs. You know, they like this one or they like that one. And they're free to choose the pieces of candy that they ate. Well, as adults, we pick and choose too, but on a little more serious level. We pick and choose which passages in here that we want to follow and which commandments we kind of like today or don't like today. Here's an example. That whole second greatest commandment, love your neighbor thing, here's kind of how we do it. That neighbor is kind of like chocolate. We like chocolate, so we'll love that neighbor. Then this neighbor over here, he's kind of like that sour candy that we really don't like, and so we just ignore that commandment when it comes to that neighbor. So we pick and choose how we're going to walk out the things God has called us to, how we're going to love and love well. And then sometimes we go to the coffee shop or the break room, and we're sitting there, and everybody's gossiping, and we're complaining that they're sinning and gossiping, and all the while, we're ignoring all the commandments that we have missed out. Or maybe at the restaurant, there's someone living a lifestyle that you don't approve of, all the while you're living a lifestyle that God doesn't approve of. We criticize others for not serving at church when we haven't even opened our Bible in a few days, or maybe a week, or a month. God's Word is not a buffet where we can get in line and just take the pieces that we like. You know, the chocolate and not the sour candy. He didn't say choose the part that you want. His Holy Word is without error and infallible. It's not pinata candy that we can just discard the pieces that we don't like. Here's what God says. You shall not add to the word that I command you, nor take from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord God that I command you. Then in Revelation, I warn everyone who hears the words of this prophecy of this book. If anyone adds to them, God will add to him the plagues described in this book. And if anyone takes away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God will take away his share in the tree of life and in the holy city that is described in this book. God is serious about we, his followers, knowing and adhering to the entirety of his words. Are we going to be perfect? Absolutely not. But we need to strive to do our best to obey the commandments he has left for us. If we're going to be light in this dark world, if we're going to love and love well, we need to be a people that follow this word. Let's pray. Father, this morning, I pray, Lord, that we at Cape County Cowboy Church would be just that kind of people, the kind of people who open up your word, who study it, and study it not just for knowledge, Father, but, Lord, that we may live out day in and day out, and that we may be known by a people that love and love well because we are living according to your word. In your name I pray. Amen.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. Been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the night tonight. And I couldn't earn it, don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh. Now I was your foe, fought for me. You've been so, so good to me. And I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You've been so, so kind. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found.
never going to not try to find you, even if you don't know he's looking. So grasp that and know when he has you forever. You know, that's such a sweet peace to have, that we have a God that loves us even when we don't love him.
No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Thou art, and sings my soul.
with a shout of acclamation and lead me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow with humble adoration and then proclaim. How great thou art, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Me, let's pray. Father, we just come to you, Lord. Father, we come to you honoring the fact that you're a great God and the greatest thing about you is the way that you love, oh Lord. So, Father, we come to worship you. We've come to praise you. We've come to humble ourselves before you and your word. And Holy Spirit, would you make it alive and challenge our hearts and change our hearts and let our lives follow you, fall deeper in love with you and share the love that we found in you with each and every person we come across. And we pray it in Jesus' name. And amen. Let me just say, if you're a youth and if you want to have a great time, if you want to worship our Lord, then I want to challenge you to be a part of a great worship time each Sunday night at 5 o'clock. I snuck in on it last week, and it was fabulous. Made me wish I were young again. Do I need to swap microphones? I can do that real quick. We'll try that again. All right, here we go. Amen. Everybody got a smile on them? Amen. Yeah, it doesn't cost anything to smile, and they're greatly appreciated by all who receive. Interesting, this morning about 2 o'clock, I woke up, and, you know, sometimes as a minister of the gospel and the word of God, you get what it is, and what it is gets you, but sometimes you don't know how to unpack it, how to unpack it away that it will somehow or another be graspable by you, that you can receive it and that it can become yours and take it home with you. And that's my goal as I preach, is that would happen. And so at 8 o'clock, we always have our worship services at Gravel Hill, and I unpacked it, and I don't think it unpacked real well. And so it's 30 minutes from there to here. Lord, today would be a good day for the rapture. You've got 30 minutes to take me home. I mean, you know, it just wasn't working. I mean, it's still working for me, but I'm not giving up. So will you be gracious? It's all right to be. Now, I don't only need grace, but I need mercy. Some of you, I'm coming up after you. Some of you are the most unmerciful looking people I've ever seen in my life. And you're worried that I'm going to stop at your seat and I might just stop at yours. But, you know, your face could express some mercy somewhere. In the store, whenever you go in the store, they like to see people with a little mercy. They like to see people with a little joy. They like to see people with a whole lot of love. So let your face from up there. Come on, bring it down. Bring me some. I'm believing in you, brother. I wish you could sit down here and watch. This is I'm not charging you a thing for this extra sermon here. But if you go to work, or if you go home, or if you go to a shop, or if you come to church wearing the face that I get down here, people are going to say, man, I don't know what they got, but I don't want it. Think about that. We got the sound going? Amen, guys. Y'all are doing a good job. Let's go on if we can. Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, if we might. And you can look a little bit down there if you'd like to at this wonderful chapter. Interesting, as a Christian, don't you wish everybody could see this word and experience this faith and desire to worship just like you? Seriously. Don't you wish everybody could just do it right, just like you? But does it ever frustrate you sometimes because everybody doesn't? Just a little bit? Whole bunch? You know, as believers, there are some things we'll never all see alike. There just aren't. And when we get to heaven, every one of us will get there, and we're going to have a whole lot of what we've got right.
Amen.
Amen? A whole lot of what we got right. But can I tell you, because our God is so big and our God is so great, that you're never going to totally figure him out on this side of heaven. There'll always be things that you don't understand about him. There will always be things when everybody, every denomination, every church, there will always be things that we just didn't have right. And that's truth. And if we can learn to live with that, you'll find a lot more peace. Now, that doesn't mean you don't quit digging for the truth. It doesn't mean that you don't keep seeking to find more understanding, more revelation of who our God is. I'm not saying that. But if you're waiting on you with your little pea brain and me with my little pea brain, can you raise your hand and say, my brain compared to God is a little pea brain? And if you think your little pea brain can figure out all there is of him, then you've got way too high of an estimation of who you are. He loves his wife and she's cooking. Lord, I'm going to pray. So, Lord, where do we find our common ground? Where do we find our common ground? That this we have together as believers, as a body, as the family. Let me read if I might. Therefore, if there's any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any afflictions and affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but also the interests of others. These verses, these four verses, have been a solace for my soul in my life for a long while. They just have. They help me to live amongst the body. They help me to live amongst the church local and the church universal. When everything's not the same about everything, but yet I can still find peace in my God. Still I can find confidence in his word. I still find leadership of his Holy Spirit. And friend, I'm telling you, that's a good thing to have. It's a good thing to guard. And if somehow or another, if you think it's your job to go about changing everybody to think just like you think, you're going to find little joy of the life that you've got in Jesus, because our job has never been to change anybody. Our job has been to receive the truth, trust the truth, and to share the truth. But our job is not to change everybody. Not to change your spouse, not to change your children, not to change your preacher. I need some changing. Not to change your person you sit beside at church. Our job is to lovingly share the truth, but love those whether they embrace it or not. And let God the Holy Spirit, the changer of hearts, the changer of minds, the changer of lives and communities and churches. Let him do the changing. Just like you can't save them, you can't change them. I can't save them, and I can't change them. But I can lovingly share, here's what I've discovered. Here's what I've discovered, and to me, this seems right. I could be wrong. I listened to some pastors on the TV and the radio, and it's like they know it all. And I scratch my head and think there's so much that I don't know, and the longer I live, there's so much more that I don't know about the greatness of my God and about the amazement of His Word and the life of His Word. Know more now than I've ever known before, but I know less than when realizing how much I don't know. So how then do we become a people of one mind and of one accord and of one love? Let me share what makes sense to me, and I could be wrong, but I tell you, it works for me. If there's any consolation in Christ, if there's any comfort of love, if there's any fellowship of the Spirit, if there's any affection and mercy, has anybody in Christ, has anybody received consolation in Christ? Those words of encouragement, those words of I believe in you, those words of that a boy, that Christ has come along beside you in everyday living, that He's done that for you. He spoke that to you through an individual. It might have been through a card that you received. It might have been through a sermon that you heard. It might have been through a song that you sang. I mean, just when they sing about the reckless love of God that left the 99, whenever I heard that words of that song sung, I got to thinking about Him leaving the 99 and came recklessly after me. He'd climb the mountains. He'd go through the valleys. He'd swim the river. Whatever it took to get me, He got me. Whew, that consolation to my soul that I'm of value to Him. Whew, I've got some. How about you? And it comes in so many forms and so many fashions through so many different people. Some people I really like and some that I don't like as well, but it still comes. Whew. So if you've received any of that, then God's got a word for you. If you've received any comfort of His love, whew, oh yeah, the comfort of the love of God. The comfort. Jesus loves me. This I know for the Bible, for His Word. It tells me so. I mean, just that little song of this great truth of this great Word is the fact that He loves us. For God so loved me and God so loved you. I mean, oh, surely there's some comfort that you've received from the truth of that Word, some consolation for this ministry to your heart. And if there's any fellowship of the Spirit in any affections and mercies, fellowship of God, the Holy Spirit living in you, making manifest to you that He is there, manifesting to you His ability to give you abilities through gifts, His ability to make the Word of God come alive unto you and to reveal the truth of His Word. And, I mean, just so much of the fellowship of the Spirit to comfort you, to guide you, to walk along beside you, the paraclete that's right there with you. If you've received any of that fellowship, and if you've ever received the affection of Christ and the mercies of Christ, and the answer of all these things are yes. If you have, then Paul says, fulfill my joy for those of us that have received it. How do we fulfill His joy? And by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Now, here's where I struggled. Lord, I know we're to be of one mind. Lord, I know we're to be like-minded. But, Lord, we've been at this for over 2,000 years. Come on. And we're not there yet as a body of believers. Locally, universally, we're not there yet, and so surely it can't mean that we're all doctrinally the same. Surely it's not that, because we're not. Surely it's not because we all have the same methods of doing church. I mean, you line up any two churches and the method that they carry out, the practical part, the spiritual part, the social part, it is different. Surely it's we don't all worship the same. We don't even worship the same songs on the same days and on the same weeks. You know what I'm saying? We do different in the week. So, Lord, if that's what it is, then, God, we're a long, 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 I mean, really long, long, long way from it. So, Lord, where are our minds the same as believers? Where are our hearts the same as all believers? The atmosphere of the kingdom of God is love. The teaching of the school of Christ in our hearts is love. And the Word of God says, they shall know that you're Christians by the doctrines that you hold. They will know that you're Christians by the denomination that you're part of. They will know that you're a Christian by the worship style that you have. The only thing he says, they will know that we are Christians by our love. It's by our love. And I got to thinking a little bit about this in a practical way. On my dad's side, we gather together, and whenever we do, families grow, and first there's kids and grandparents had kids and then grandkids and great-grandkids, and as we all kind of gather, we're all over the map. I mean, fortunately, we're all believers, but Lord have mercy in our faith. We come from all different avenues. We've got all different, so many different interpretations. We've got different lifestyles that we live. Some are country and some are not. They're city and some are very techie and some are very redneck. And so, you know what I mean? I mean, just all over in our lifestyles, the way we live and in our financial state, our place of social society, where it's different in all this. And so we come and we're so different. But I found that whenever one topic comes up, we're all the same. All you've got to do is mention my grandpa Ben's name. And everybody is of one accord. Everybody is one of mine. Everybody has one love of somebody that influenced our life more than anybody else in our lives. It's always him in the midst of that conversation. And I got to thinking about that and thought, well, Lord, that's the way it is amongst us. It's that one affection that we are of one mind. It is of that one love that we are of one accord. One love for him and therefore one love for others that are of him. I'm convinced that it's the thing that binds us. I'm convinced that it's that arena of love. It's that arena of being loved and then loved. It's that arena of love that we can come and we can talk about our differences of understanding in the scripture that's bigger than any one mind or any one generation or any one whatever. It's bigger than that. It's bigger than that. Humble yourself and say, it is bigger than what I know about what I know about by God. It is bigger about what I know about what I know about my Bible, and I'm glad it's bigger because I want it bigger than me. But whenever we've got a spirit of love for him and knowing he loves us, it spills over to each other. Amen. Then we can sit down and say, gosh, I don't see it quite that way, but this is how I see it. And oh, man, I never seen that until you shared that with me. You see what I'm saying? Because there's love. All of a sudden, we're not throwing stones. This all got generated out of preachers getting on TV and just picking on one another. I think we've got a lost world to bring to Jesus. We need every soldier that we got doing all that we can, and we need to keep fighting together as a team. The very same thing you're saying about the Congress, the very same thing you're saying about Washington, we as a church need to do that. We're going to come different, but we can find some things that we got in common to reach that lost world, because God loves us and we know it, and we love Him, and because He loves us and we love Him, how can we not love others and each other as believers? Amen?
Amen.
Oh, gosh, I don't know if this is getting anywhere. I just needed it. I'm feeling better already. Guys, that's the platform of one mind. No matter what happens in my life, God loves me.
Whew,
and I know it. And I love Him. And we love Him. I mean, that's a common chord amongst us. But also is that commitment to not only love Him, but because of that we can love each other. And for me, it's that footing. Paul prayed in Ephesians chapter 3 that you might know the love of Christ that's able to make you rooted and established. We find stable ground to stand on is knowing how much we are loved by Him. The height and the depth and the width and the length of the love of God toward us, it makes us stable. But it's the stability among us as a people. I grew up in a Southern Baptist church. I'm not better than you, not worried from you, but you know the reason I was a Southern Baptist? My grandparents were. And my parents who took me to church, they were. And so when I came to faith, I became one. Okay, that's how I got there. How'd you become a Lutheran? How'd you become a Pentecost? Much the same way. The pastors we had, the sermons were usually kind of three categories. One was to be saved, and I love that part. Another was Catholics are wrong. Don't date them and sure don't marry them. I'm just telling you. I'm not saying that's what I believe. I'm telling you what I heard. And back then in the younger days, it was always a scriptural debate from our pulpit towards all the people that we work with to take to them against Church of Christ. And if you turned on the radio at 2 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon, you could hear them debating each other. One of the neatest things I've found out as I've grown in my faith is we all know the same Jesus. We all love the same Jesus. He loves us. Amen. And as I started to embrace that, one of the neat things about this church, we're probably 40 to 60% Catholic Lutheran around here. That's why I didn't marry any of you. I'm just joking. But see, just to say that makes some of you cringe. Jim, you know that denomination you just talked about. You know the Catholic. They got some things that aren't right. And you don't. And we don't. You take any of those sections out of the history of the Church of Jesus. You take any of them out. And there's a big void of what we understand and what we come to learn about our God that we found out through them. Did they know it all? No. Do they do it right? No. But we don't either. I'm not saying that's right. I'm not saying to embrace the wrong. But I am saying it's going to happen because we're human.
Amen.
But there's a commonness among us all. And we found it to be true here. We've got all makes and models of Christianity amongst us. And I've never been a church that got along better than we do. And I've never been a part of one that's got along better than we do. Because there's a sense among us that we might not see it alike, but know this, I love you and I love the same God you do. And that's good enough. We can start from there. We can work from there. Got to have some ground to start a conversation with. Got to have some place you've got in common. I'm just talking as a pastor. Needed somebody to listen. I can't afford a counselor. And so here I am. Here's some neat things. I stole this from somebody, but I liked it. I don't remember who it was. When we love each other, loving each other, number one, is always in our power to do. No matter who it is you're loving, no matter what it is they do or don't do, it's always within your power to love somebody else. Loving each other never violates our theological doctrinal stands. You say, well, Jim, I can't love him. We see things different in places in scriptures. Oh, yeah, you can. It's not going to make you change your mind. It's not going to make you require you to give up your stance. It's just loving somebody. Loving each other works in every language, every nation, and every age bracket. There's nothing like love, my friend. Loving others, it never divides us. It never divides us. If we ever had a time in our nation that we need to love each other, I'm telling you, it is now. Amen. And if we'll love each other, it doesn't mean that you have to become a Republican if you're a Democrat or a Democrat if you're a Republican. It doesn't mean that. It won't change that. It doesn't have to change that. But still, we can love each other. Yes. Loving each other never violates our conscience. Two more things. Loving others is a great witness to the unsaved. And the third thing is loving each other, I promise you, is going to increase your joy. So he calls us. He said, if you've experienced this, then fulfill my joy by being like-minded of one love and one mind and of one accord. We find all of that in loving our Lord and loving others. But the next thing it says, it goes on and says this. It says, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others. Number one was like-mindedness. Number two is lowly-minded. Lowly-minded in the sense of humbling ourselves with an attitude, with a lifestyle that seeks to humble ourselves. It says, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit. Nothing. Matter of fact, There's no greater enemy to love than pride. And say, well, why is that, Jim? So number one is the fact that pride's all about ourselves and love is about others. Number two, it's about being seen. And love's about looking at others and seeing them for what they need and who they are and where they are. Number three is love's about what can I get. I mean, pride's about what can I get. And love's about what can I give? Pride's about serve me, and love's about me serving them. God resists the proud, Scripture says, but gives grace to the humble. Pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit is before a fall. It says in Proverbs 28, it says, he that is of a proud heart stirreth up strife. And it says also in Proverbs 13, it says, but by pride cometh nothing but strife. All this is of pride. And notice what Scripture says here. And it says, these things that the Lord hate. Yes, even seven are an abomination unto him. Now, what are these things? Now, what's interesting, all the things that people are preparing posters about, saying this is an abomination to God, it doesn't make the top six or the top seven either. In the top of the list, a proud look. I like what one man said. I wrote it down. This isn't scripture, but I liked it. He said, pride is the only disease that makes everybody sick but the one who has it. But what Paul is calling us to is to humble ourselves to others. Calling us to be willing to give value to who they are. As much value as we receive ourselves. Humbling ourselves unto others. It says, in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. We need to learn to be severe on our own faults and charitable on our judgment of others. We need to quit worrying about the tiny speck of wood that's in their eye and get the log that's out of our eye. We need to be quick in observing our own defects, but ready to overlook the defects of others. I always tell this because it works for me in living in life, but raised pretty much on one side by a man that was like a grandfather to me in the horse area. And he always said this. He said, Jim, if you ever buy a horse that's, you know, really not worth much, he said, keep, if he's got, you know, only three good legs and one bad one, keep your eye on his pretty head. Don't ever look at that fourth leg that's not working, you know. Just keep looking at what's good about him. Just keep looking at what's good about him. He said, you'll eventually be able to sell him. But if all you do is concentrate on that fact that he's a three-legged horse, you'll never be able to sell him. Can I see the deal going on? If all you do, this is what gets me. I don't understand this. Somebody will come out and they'll see things different than another person, and all of a sudden, everything that person does is wrong. I love C.S. Lewis. I love his teachings. I love his writing. He has made such an impact on Christianity, but there were some things about his life I really didn't like at all. But I did not throw the baby out with the bathwater. I threw some of the bathwater out and say, that water's not for me, but all the rest of this is for me. And I've gained much in my life by the books that he wrote, by the lessons that he taught, that Christianity preserved them. But what's so odd is these classics of Christianity, if we do like so many want to do, is get a group and throw the person out, we would have missed all this great stuff out of them. I'm not saying that you're saying what's wrong is right. I'm not saying that, but love them. See what's good in them. See what's good in the neighbor beside you. See what's good in them. The person that works with you. Humble yourself. Esteem others higher than yourself. Highlight the good which is in others above that which is in us. Let each one of you look out not of his own interests, but for the interest of others. Today, I don't know where this fit. It might not have fit at all in your walk of the faith right now. But I'm telling you, I've got to fight the fight against pride. I've got to fight the fight against selfishness. I've got to fight the fight that think that only I am right. And if you don't see it my way, it's the highway for you. I've got to fight the fight that I might be wrong when I get there, and you may be right even when I think you're wrong. But here's the crazy thing. I might be right even when you think you're wrong. I'm wrong. Got to fight those fights for the sake of the kingdom, for the sake of the body. My brother's my absolute best friend. Hardly every day I don't call him three times a day or he calls me. Can I tell you, growing up, it wasn't always that way. He would make me so mad. He would make me so. I was easy to go. You know, patience last week, that sermon, slow to boil. He knew I was quick to boil. And he knew how to push the buttons. And he was bigger and stronger. And, I wish my mama had never had him. Why do we have to live in the same house? But you know something crazy happened? We stuck it out. We stuck it out, me and him, my brother. You know the brother I wanted to throw out? The brother, if I'd been strong enough, I would have whipped him. We stuck it out. And for long, that brother I didn't like so much, I started learning to like. When I was a freshman, he was a senior. He came up to me one night and said, I'm taking you with me someplace. Where are you taking me? I'm taking you to a place that you're going to see a lot of things you probably shouldn't see, and don't tell your mama. says, I want you to see how stupid these kids look. And he was the same age as they were. How stupid they look drunk. He said, I don't care what your friends tell you. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. For me, I never chose to drink a drop. I know others do. I'm not trying to pick the fight. But all of a sudden, he started stepping into my life. Hey, come go with me. Hey, you want to partner this in business? I'm so glad he didn't throw me out. I'm so glad I didn't throw him out. And in spite of our differences yet, I wouldn't trade him for anybody's brother. If that can happen there, and it has, it can happen here if we'll let it. The world needs this kind of love in every aspect of our lives. Quit calling names. Quit finding fault. Quit putting down. Our job is to pick up. Our job is to encourage. And whenever we do differ in grace, differ, my friend. I'm not saying we're all alike. I'm not saying that we can't express where we come from and why we get to where we've got. I'm not saying you can't do that. But by golly, be gracious as unto the Lord. If we found any consolation, if we found any comfort, if we found any affection and mercy, surely we can give it to others. Surely we can. So I'm going to quit talking. I'm 1 minute over. But I get an extra minute because the mic wasn't working. Y'all remember that, don't you? Got me working good, Steve. I love you guys. I wouldn't have your job for nothing. Let me pray. Father, we come, and Lord, I'm so thankful that you're so patient with us. And God, you're the God that knows all. You know it all before all was all. Lord, you know it before the foundation of this world. Lord, you knew we would be coming. You knew we'd need a Savior. And you knew your Son Christ Jesus would be our Savior. You knew it all. And Lord, you're the only one. You're the absolute only one that knows when you're coming back, God. You're the only one. Not one soul knows the day and the time you're coming back. Nobody knows that but you. But yet, oh God, you're so kind and gracious and forbearing and long-suffering with us whenever we get that puffed-up deal thinking we've figured it all out. And you've got to be laughing because we've been able to figure some out, no doubt. But on no way and on no day will we ever figure it all out. You're just that great of a God. So, Lord, as you're gracious and patient with us, as you seek to find our good and overlook, let your love cover a multitude of our sin, God. Oh, Lord, let us do it one with another. And I just want to pray this, Lord, for each one of us individually. I want to pray this for us as citizens of this nation. I want to pray this for us as members of this church, that we would have that kind of love in a world that doesn't get to experience that kind of love if they don't know you yet. And for in Christ's name and for his glory, I pray this prayer. Amen. God bless you. We're dismissed.